Well, Palm Sunday marks the beginning of Holy Week that we enter into. And this morning I want to help you understand something of what happened on Palm Sunday when the crowds cheered, "Hosanna, Hosanna," and then only 5 days later they're yelling, "Crucify him." What shifted? And in order to do that, we're going to kind of start at the end of Good Friday, and we're going to kind of work our way backwards. When you get to the end of Good Friday, and you're standing there, and if you were looking, you would see three crosses, thieves still hanging on the outside, two crosses. But on the center cross, well, it's empty. Obviously, the victim has already died and has been taken off. But over top, there's a sign that says, "King of the Jews." It's written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Why did Jesus die? How could he be executed as an enemy of Rome? Well, that Friday, there's a lot of mixed motives, secret meetings, and the politicians and the chief priests playing games. And it becomes clear that everybody on that day had their own agenda. I want us to look at some of the major players. First of all, Rome. Jerusalem is part of the Roman Empire, and they play a big part behind the scenes. Rome would say that Jesus died because he was a threat to Rome. Any threat to Rome must die. Why was he a threat? We say Jesus Christ, and often, you know, I'm Ron Cartmell. Is Christ his last name? No, Christ actually means the anointed one, the Messiah. And if you can understand Jesus, you need to understand Messiah. In Jesus' day, there were many people who claimed to be the Messiah. They were trying to lead a political revolution against Rome. The crowds were another major player. The people of Israel who lived in Jerusalem wanted out from underneath the Roman Empire. They were an occupied people and they didn't like it. And they're waiting for a political leader, a Messiah, to lead them in a revolt against Rome. And the coming Messiah would be a very powerful figure and the people would rally around him. Here's something that you should know. There were a number of wannabe messiahs at the time of Jesus, the first century. We read about one of them in Acts chapter 5. Some time ago, Theudas appeared claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied around him. He was killed. Josephus, who's a historian at the time, who wasn't a follower of Jesus, so he writes this unbiased history, says that Thaddeus actually called himself the Messiah, and many people followed him, and he claimed that he could part the Jordan River. He claimed that he could make the walls of Jerusalem crumble, just like Jericho had done so many years before. He led a revolt against Rome and ended up being captured by the Romans, and the Romans brought him in and decapitated him in front of the crowds. The message, don't mess with Rome. There's another wannabe Messiah called Judas the Galilean, and he led a band of people in revolt, and he was killed by Rome. Josephus tells us that Judas founded a group called the Zealots. Judas said, "God alone is the God of Israel. Caesar is an idol. Don't pay taxes to Caesar." Judas the Galilean had a bunch of people take up arms and follow him, and they got captured. Rome crucified 2,000 of them. Through the Galilean hillsides, listen to this. When the people finally died and they took the people off the cross, they left those crosses up. The message, any of you that decide to follow somebody that decides to call themselves the Messiah, look it, we got some empty crosses just waiting for you. Jesus grew up in Galilee. As a boy, he would have walked by these crosses where people had been put to death because they followed somebody that they thought was the Messiah. There were 18 separate men that referred to themselves as Messiah in Jesus' day. Every one of them got crucified. Now, Jesus was crucified, but not because he was one of the military Messiah wannabe kings. In fact, Jesus deliberately rejected that role, even though that's what his disciples wanted. In John 11, we read these words, that the crowds intended to come and make him king. That's after he fed the 4,000 people. The people want a Messiah that's going to take down Rome. Jesus won't do it. So why does Jesus end up on the cross? Well, we have to go from the end of that Friday to something that happened earlier. When the chief priests bring Jesus before a man that's known in history as Pontius Pilate. Now, let me tell you a little about Pilate. He rules over Judah on behalf of Caesar. Pilate's job really was a headache. Nobody really wanted this job being Caesar's representative in the Middle East. The Middle East didn't just start having tension in the last few decades. It's always been that way. He has to make the best of a bad situation. He didn't ask for this assignment. He drew the short straw, but now he's got to make the best of it if he's going to work his way up the food chain. This is what he has to deal with. They're the chief priests. These are the ones that are in charge of the temple. They have a narrow line to walk, and if you needed a word to describe the chief priests, they were the collaborators. They have to stay close enough to Rome so that Rome will let them still do their work in the temple. But they have a huge garrison right beside the temple, and Rome controls that, and then Rome controls the temple. And the chief priests have to walk this narrow line of saying, how do we stay cozy enough with the Romans so that they let us do what we want to do in the temple, but not be seen by the people as in cahoots with them? See, the people of Israel already thought that the high priests were selling out. So they walked this really narrow road. Then there's another group called the Pharisees, and they're the teachers of the Old Testament law, and if you were to put a label beside them, that'd be the purists. And they would say that if we would only obey the Old Testament, and we'd get on our knees, and we'd confess, and we'd get back to prioritizing the commands of God, God would take care of the Romans. We need to confess. Then there's another group, the Zealots. Talked about them a moment ago, and their word would be fight. They would say, Rome is evil, Rome is bad, we ought to be courageous and take them down. If we do, God will bless us. Then there's another group called the Essenes. Their strategy was withdraw. These are the ones that wrote the scriptures and hid them in the caves, the Dead Sea Scrolls at Qumran. Qumran was a community of Essenes. They said, Rome is evil and the whole temple structure, it's corrupt. And we're not going to the temple and we're not going to make sacrifices. We are going to be this little community and we're going to protect ourselves from the corruption that's out there, and eventually God is going to wipe it out and we will have preserved the remnant. These groups very often didn't get along. Sometimes they'd make alliances with each other, depending on what side they got out of bed that day. But they were always at odds with each other. This is what Pilate's job was to juggle. An ancient writer, Philo, says that Pilate's rule was marked by bribery, insults, robberies, supreme cruelties, executions even without trials, and a furious, vindictive temper. The life of Jesus is in the hands of this man, Pilate. So the chief priests bring Jesus to Pilate. This is their charge. We found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be the Christ. Why would the chief priests be concerned about paying taxes to Caesar? They're not in the least. But what they want to do is manipulate Pilate So they'll say whatever it takes to get their way. Pilate, think of it this way. If Jesus is a problem for Rome, Caesar won't like it. It won't make you look good. Pilate, for his part, doesn't want to have anything to do with what the chief priests are wanting him to do. He's going to resist at every level. And it's all political. It's all about power. Pilate's position is, if I give in to you, you're going to look good and I'm going to look bad. So I'm not going to look good, make you look good. As it turns out, Pilate turns, or it's not about doing what's right. It's all about politics. When Pilate finds out that Jesus is from Galilee, he says, oh, I'm sending you to Herod. That way I can still look good. And I don't have to give in to you. Herod's not going to touch this with a 10-foot pole. And at this point, Pilate turns to the crowd and says, there's a custom at feast time to release a prisoner. You should do what? Do you want me to release Barabbas, the murderer, or Jesus, who is harmless? And the crowd says, Barabbas. Now, Barabbas is a murderer, but at least he's willing to kill Roman soldiers. That's why he's on trial. Jesus won't even lift a finger against the Romans. If we let Barabbas go, in all likelihood, he'll take out a few more. Clearly, this whole attempt to kill Jesus is trumped up anyway, and Pilate knows that. He could care less about some powerless, harmless Messiah. His agenda was to maintain the upper hand in the temple and with the high priests. But the high priests have a trump card. Listen to what they say to Pilate. If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be king, referring to Jesus, is no friend of Caesar. And then the chief priests say something that would have turned their stomach to say, because it was exactly opposite of what they believed. We have no king but Caesar. So what does Caesar want out of this? Well, Caesar wants corn. He had an empire that needed to be fed, and the grain, the corn was grown in Egypt and in the Middle East. We think of the Middle East as where the oil is. 2,000 years ago, that is where the corn was grown. Wars were fought over corn. You can think of it this way. Jesus died so Caesar could get his grain to keep his kingdom going. Pilate could not risk Caesar think that he was soft on anti-Roman terrorists. So he turns to Jesus and he says, are you the king of the Jews? Now, depending on how Jesus answers, he could go free. And this is very ironic, because earlier in his ministry, people just kept saying to him, are you the Messiah? All he had to do is one time say, yes, that is me. And the people would have gathered around behind him and they would have taken up swords and they would have gone after Rome, but he never says it. That's what Palm Sunday's all about. Jerusalem is celebrating Passover. Passover was always an explosive time in Jerusalem when they always had more Roman soldiers on, because you never knew what was going to break out. But do you remember what they were celebrating at Passover? See, Moses rose up with great courage and called his people to overthrow the oppressor, Egypt. Moses led the charge against Pharaoh, and God honored their faith and destroyed Pharaoh and his army. That's what Israel is celebrating on that Passover Sunday in Jerusalem that day. Now it's not Egypt and Pharaoh that's the enemy. It's Rome and it's Caesar. This young leader, Jesus, comes riding into Jerusalem when people are celebrating Passover and everybody is shouting, Hosanna, son of David, the warrior king. And Jesus won't fight. He won't claim the title. And throughout the Gospels, we see this over and over again. When Jesus is up in Samaria, he'll tell people he's the Messiah. When he's in Israel, those words do not come from his lips. On Palm Sunday, people are saying, here is our leader for the revolution. But Jesus won't revolt. And that's why The crowds turn on him between Palm Sunday and Good Friday. Now, when he stands before Pilate, when it's too late to save him, there's no one around except the chief priests and Pilate. Now, when he has no other choice of having an army rise up around him, Jesus finally gives a definitive answer to Pilate. When there's no chance of being misunderstood, Jesus responds, "Yes, Pilate, it is as you say. I'm the one they're waiting for. I'm the king. I am their king." And Jesus knows what's going to happen to him. Pilate pronounces the sentence. But Pilate didn't want it that way. And to make sense of this, we got to go back to what happened earlier on that Good Friday. Why did the chief priests want Jesus to die? Now, shortly before Good Friday, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, and people are talking about him all the time. So the Pharisees and the chief priests have a meeting, and one of them says, "Here is this man, Jesus, performing many miraculous signs, and if we let him go on like this, everybody's going to believe him, and then the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." John 11. And that wasn't necessarily hypothetical, because in the year 70 AD, one too many wannabe messiahs came along, and Rome just moved in with their troops, and they destroyed the temple and pretty well annihilated the Israel nation. See, the chief priests knew that was going to come, and Jesus did too. Then the high priest Caiaphas spoke up. "Do you not realize it's better for you that one man dies for the people than the whole nation perish?" The Apostle John says Caiaphas was saying way more than he knew. One man was going to die for Israel, but not just for Israel. Jesus was going to die for the whole world. And the priests knew that if the unrest was too strong in Jerusalem, then Rome would step in and destroy everything. The priest also knew that Jesus was not a military threat. They understood his teaching and knew that his movement created a threat of a different kind. Jesus was claiming, he was living, he was manifesting that the kingdom of God that everybody had been waiting for was somehow now present on earth. That the love of God, the power of God, the grace of God, the salvation of God was now present. But it wasn't in the temple. It wasn't in the sacrifices. It was through Jesus. Through this one man, though, what he said, how he lived, and how he loved. No one had ever done this before. Nobody had ever thought like this before. And the priests knew that they could not let this stand. So before the court hearing with Pilate, there's another meeting of the Sanhedrin, which is the old Supreme Court system that they'd pulled over from the Old Testament, when the Pharisees and the priests would gather together for a meeting to determine different things. They have Jesus arrested very early Friday morning, and they have their little trial before they take him to Pilate. We're told that this happens before sunrise, while it's still dark, so that it can be done in secret, because the Sanhedrin had a very difficult task to perform. Here's the situation. They have to get the crowds to hate Jesus, and they have to get Pilate, Rome, to crucify Jesus. Now, the quickest way to get Pilate to crucify Jesus is to say that he's a threat to Rome. But as soon as you say that Jesus is a threat to Rome, what's that do to the people? They go, "Oh, great, finally." So now they got to drum up two charges. So they charge Jesus with blasphemy, so the crowd will hate him for blaspheming the God of Israel. And for Pilate, they charge Jesus with treason, so he will have him killed because he's not a friend of Caesar. Mark 14 records these words, because in reality, they couldn't get it done. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so they could put him to death, but they could not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Once again, all Jesus has to do is remain silent. And once again, Jesus did not remain silent. Now that he's arrested with absolutely no help at his disposal, he makes no attempt to correct their false accusations. He makes no attempt to explain his mission correctly. He sits in silence while they mock him. But when they ask him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" he makes this one statement, "I am." Jesus uses this little Greek phrase in the Old Testament used for the name of God, "I am." You will see the Son of Man descending on the clouds. When Jesus says this, he is pronouncing his own death sentence. He's not saying you're going to see a body floating down from the sky. He's using an image out of the Old Testament to say, you now see God present and at work uniquely through me. And with that, Jesus hands them what they need for their verdict that they could not get from all their false witnesses. Jesus essentially does their work for them. Why? Well, we got to back up just a little bit more. Before the cross, before the meeting with Pilate, before the meeting of the Sanhedrin, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, a place called Gethsemane. The story of the human race begins in the Garden of Eden with the first Adam. The second story of the second Adam, that is Jesus, will end there. When Jesus is in the garden, he has a lot of options. He could fight like the zealots. He's young, he's got charisma, and the crowds would follow him to their death. Or he could withdraw. Like the Essenes, he could go into the desert and live in a safe little community. Or he could collaborate with the chief priests. Imagine if Jesus had the temple as a platform for his teaching. Imagine what he could do. Or he could cut a deal with Pilate. Think of what Jesus could have done to influence the Roman Empire from the inside. Or he could have called his father and asked for a legion of angels to come and just sweep him out of this. It'd just be one more miracle. But Jesus doesn't do any of those things. In the garden, this one lone, deserted, vulnerable man says, "I know what I must do. I will not fight. I will not run. I will die. Not my will, Father, but yours be done." Jesus dies out of love for others. Jesus knows that rebels always die, so he dies on the cross in the place of a rebel, like Barnabas or like Barabbas. He literally saves Barabbas's life by dying on the cross. Jesus knows the crowds are waiting for a word from him, and they will go out and kill a bunch of Romans. A lot of Roman soldiers are still employed because Jesus decides not to say that word, but to die. Jesus knows that if he flees, his disciples would be gathered up and executed. That's what happened to other followers of other messiahs. The disciples knew that. Jesus knew that. And by Jesus choosing to die, he saves the disciples' lives. Jesus knows that if he says the words, a crowd will follow him, and Caesar will send down legions of soldiers and destroy Jerusalem. Jesus dies to save Jerusalem. Jesus dies for all the people that hate him. And Jesus says, "I will lay down my life for the people who do not understand." And that will buy a little bit of time. That way, a little community, my church, can be formed, and out of sacrificial love, it can begin to change the world. When you think of the cross, Jesus died out of remarkable brilliance, from his breathtaking courage to his inexplicable love. He sized up the situation, defeated every human attempt at correction. He identified exactly what needed to bring redemption, and it cost him everything. It cost him his life. But he was exactly right, because we sit here 2,000 years later because of the church that he instituted. Pilate, who did not intend to be anybody's mouthpiece, ends up writing out in Hebrew, the language of God's people, in Greek, the language of the cultured world, in Latin, the language of the Roman Empire, that the whole world could read it, the good news, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Jesus outfought, outmaneuvered, outcrafted every group, every power. Most of all, he outloved everyone because Jesus in the garden had one agenda. The agenda for Jesus was simply, I will love, I will die on Friday. On Friday, Jesus dies for the world, not because of anyone else. It wasn't Pilate, it wasn't Herod, it wasn't the chief priests or the Sanhedrin. It wasn't even the crowds. Jesus said, I lay down my life for the sheep. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have the authority to lay it down and the authority to take it up again. This command I receive from my Father. John 15. On Friday, Jesus dies for the world. On Friday, God declares his heart for you and me and every person that's ever lived and ever will live on the face of this earth. On Friday in a garden, he made a decision. On Friday in a garden, Jesus said, I will suffer. I will die. I will choose love. So how do you respond to that kind of love? My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. I'm going to invite you to sing that with me as your declaration. When you start to understand how much Jesus really loves you and me, the natural response is to surrender our lives to him. The natural response is to say, Lord, I love you. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee, all the pleasures of sin I'll set aside. You're my gracious Redeemer, my Savior. Oh, at the beginning of this Holy Week, if ever there is a time that I love you, Lord, I want to declare it. It is now. Sing it with me as your declaration of your love for Jesus.